Hello friends, welcome to a new lecture today. In our last class, we have learned about the examination of the breast. In that, we have learned about the history taking, the important aspects which we have to look in history taking. Now, let us learn about the local examination of the breast. So, in the local examination of the breast, for example, if the female has a lesion in any one of the breast, think that the female has a lesion in the right breast, then you will have to examine the left breast first and then you will have to examine the abnormal one. So always examine the normal one, normal breast, to compare with the abnormal one. Okay. So, what are the positions in which we can examine the breast? So, breast examination can be done initially. It is done in a sitting position. Okay, it is done in a sitting position initially with 45 degrees semi-recumbent position. Okay, with a sitting in 45 degrees semi-recumbent position, so that the breasts will flatten and fall sideways. Okay, that is first position. Okay, the second position is, the examination is also done in recumbent position, that is in lying down position. Now, in lying down position, we can clearly feel the lump against the chest. Now, the lump will fall against the chest wall, so it can be felt easily. And then you can also examine it by, in the sitting position itself, you'll have to examine it in two different positions. One, by raising the hand up. Raising both the hands should be raised up. In sitting position, you can examine by raising the two hands up or by keeping them on either side of the waist. You can examine it in this fashion, or by bending forward. She will sit, but she will have to bend forward. So these are the three positions in which the breast is examined in sitting position. In sitting position, the breast is examined in three different positions. One, in sitting position, and the two hands should be raised up. Second position, she will have to sit, and both the hands are kept on either sides of her waist. And in third position, she will have to sit and she will have to bend forward. So these are the three positions where the breast will be examined. And then you will have to first inspect the breast. So in inspection of the breast, the whole breasts should be inspected in all the three levels. Okay, when the person bends forward, we will know whether the whole breast is falling forward or not. Or if there is some retraction also, we will know in this position. When the bend is bending forward, we will know whether the whole breast is falling forward or whether there is ripple retraction or not. This is known in this position. If there is any carcinoma, that carcinoma will not fall forward. So that is one more thing which is important. Now, what are the things which you have to see on inspection? On inspection, what do you have to visualize? First, on inspection, you will visualize the position and extent of the breast. You will have to note this position and extent both in sideways directions and also in above-down directions. So you'll have to see the extent of the breast in all the directions, both in sideward and both in vertical and both in horizontal directions. You will have to see the position and extent of the breast. Okay, and then the second thing you'll have to see is the size of the breast. The size of the breast should be noted. If there is any asymmetry in the breast, even this should be noted. If you see, the size is large. If it is a huge fibroadenoma, whenever the person has huge fibroadenoma or huge tumors, then there is, the breast size will be large. Then you will have to see the movement of the breast. Not only that, you will have to see the size of the breast And you will also have to see the symmetry. Shape of the breast should be seen. And then you will have to see the movement of the breast. Whether the breast is able to fall forward or not. In movement, you will have to see whether the breast is able to fall forward or not. So you will, what do you see in movement? In what positions can you see? One, you will have to ask her to raise the arm upwards. So once she raises the arm upwards, you will see whether the breast is adherent to the chest wall or not. You will see whether the breast is adherent to chest wall or not. That is one thing which you see on raising the hand above the arm upwards. And you should also examine by keeping the hands on either sides of the hip. Okay, you'll have to see whether the breast movement is normal or not. And that is what you see in breast. And then you'll have to inspect the nipple. In inspection of the nipple, you will have to inspect for one, size of the nipple, and then shape of the nipple. In size and shape of the nipple, you'll have to note for nipple retraction, whether there is any nipple retraction. This nipple retraction is not just seen in the carcinoma, but it can also occur. One, it occurs in carcinoma most commonly, and then it is also seen in some benign conditions like duct ectasia or periductal mastitis. In some benign conditions like duct ectasia or periductal mastitis also, we note this nipple retraction. But how are we going to differentiate the nipple retraction in carcinoma and this periductal ectasia or periductal mastitis? So that is differentiated by the shape of the nipple retraction. If nipple retraction is circumferential, it is present on the whole circumference, then it is perfectly a carcinoma. If this nipple retraction is slit-like, then you can think that it is periductal mastitis. So based on the type of the nipple retraction, you can differentiate the whether it is a carcinoma or periductal mastitis. So if there is some swelling beneath the nipple, if there is some swelling beneath the nipple, then the nipple can become prominent. So if there is a cyst beneath the nipple, or if there is a benign tumor in the nipple, in such cases the nipple may become prominent. So even that should be taken into account. Okay, so you'll have to see whether there are some ulcerations in the nipple or skin changes, that we'll say later. So the second thing which you have to see, the surface of the nipple. So if the woman is breastfeeding, then there is a chance of fissuring and cracks which occur in nipple. So these should be looked for. And so these are the things which should be looked for. And if the surface is irregular, then there can be some carcinoma. During that time, the surface can be irregular. Then level of the nipple should be noted. So here you will see the distance. If this is the clavicle, scapula. For the nipple, you'll have to measure both vertical distance and also horizontal distance. Vertical distance should be measured from the clavicle. So from the midpoint of the clavicle, you can measure the vertical distance. And the horizontal distance can be measured from the sternum. Okay, so vertical distance should be measured from the clavicle. Vertical distance of the nipple, it should be measured from the clavicle. Whereas the horizontal distance, it is measured from the sternum, middle part of the sternum or central line. Okay, vertical distance from the sternum or from center of sternum. Okay, so this is how you will measure the level of the nipple, and you will see, or you'll measure it on both the sides. You will see whether it is equal or not on both the sides. And if there is some fibroadenoma, sometimes the nipple can displace away. If fibroadenoma, then nipple may distract or displace away from the lump. So this should also be noted. And then you will have to see and whether there is any type of discharge in the nipple. And then you will have to see the number of nipples. Sometimes there can be extra mammary nipples also, which are along the milk line. Normally, where is the milk line present? Okay. So, if you think that this is a female, the milk line, it can present, it starts from the axilla. Normally, the milk line, it starts from the axilla and it goes like this and it goes to the groin or to the thigh. So this is the milk line. Sometimes there can be presence of some other accessory nipples along this line. So even those should be noted. Okay, next. Then you will have to know the surface of the nipple, whether there is redness or you'll have to see whether there is ulceration or fungation in the nipple surface. Okay, then you will have to inspect the areola. So in the areola, you'll have to see the color of the areola. Normally, the color of the areola is pink in young girls, and it is dark colored in adults. It can become brownish in pregnancy and lactation. And it can also become red in eczema. Okay, and sometimes even in early stages of Paget's disease, this can be red. Early stages of Paget's disease, the nipple may be red. The areola may be red. So these are the color changes. These should be noted. And the size of the nipple, size of the areola, it may increase if there is any fibroadenoma or sarcoma. So even this should be noted. And you will have to know the surface of areola. Surface of the areola, it is looked for any presence of ulceration or eczema or any fungation. For that, you will have to look for ulceration of the eczema. It can ulceration of areola. It can occur in carcinoma or Paget's disease if it's localized type. So all these should be looked for, and then you'll have to look for the inspection of skin over the breast. You'll have to inspect the skin over the breast. Okay, in the skin over the breast, you will have to see if it's normal, then you'll have to say that the skin over the breast is normal, but you'll have to see about the retractions or whether there are some pigmentations or whether there are some redness or shininess, or you'll have to see whether there is some dimpling or whether there is some puckering. You'll have to note about the body orange or whether there are some nodules or whether there are some ulcerations. All these should be noted while inspecting the skin of the breast. Okay, you'll have to even note whether there are any presence of dilated veins or not. Presence of dilated veins should also be noted, because dilated veins, these are most commonly seen in cystosarcoma phylloides. And you will have to, these can also be seen in large breast abscess or any carcinomas. There can be these dilated veins. So these should be looked for. Okay, then you'll have to see for ulcerations, nodules. I have said all those. Now let us come to the swelling of the breast. Never go to the swelling of the breast first. First, you will have to see about the all the things in the breast, the all the other things, and then you'll have to come to the lump in the breast. So first and foremost, in the lump in the breast, you will have to note in the studying the lump, you will have to note the its location, in which quadrant is it located. If you see, the breast is divided into four quadrants, keeping areola, sorry, nipple in the midline. So you'll divide it into four quadrants. This is, if this is the sternum, it is upper medial, upper lateral, lower medial and lower lateral. You'll have to see where the lump is situated, and then you'll have to know about the number of lumps, whether it is one or two, then you'll have to see the extent of the lump. Where is it extending? Is it extending 4 centimeters from the sternum? Or in that way, you can tell the extent of the lump, and you'll have to see about the size and shape of the lump. Whether it is round, oval, shape, or what is the size, you'll have to measure the size approximately, and you'll have to tell the size and shape of the lump. And you'll have to see whether the margins are well-defined or ill-defined, and whether the surface or skin surface of the lump should be noted. And then the skin over the swelling, is it normal or not? The skin over the lump, is it normal or is it engorged or is it reddened? Erythematous, all these should be noted. So the examination of the swelling is similar to any other swelling in the body. The only difference is you'll have to examine the whole breast first, and then you'll have to go to the swelling. Okay, and then once you have inspected the swelling, you'll have to inspect. So you'll have to see about the inspection of axilla and supraclavicular fossa. You'll have to inspect for supraclavicular. You'll have to inspect for the presence of any other swellings, because lymph nodes can be enlarged because of this breast cancer. So you'll have to look for any other swellings in the axilla and supraclavicular nodes. Now, you'll also have to inspect the arm and thorax. Why? Because there can be, whenever there is malignancy, whenever this malignancy is spreading to the axillary lymph nodes, see, if there is cancer in the breast, this cancer which is there, this can spread into the axillary lymph nodes, and these axillary lymph nodes, they can compress the blood supply. So as a result, there can be lymphatic obstruction, or there can be obstruction to the venous flow. Okay, so that can be seen. So lymphatic obstruction or obstruction to venous flow, this can form edema in the breast. So this edema is most commonly called as Brawny edema. Okay, so this edema should also be looked for. Not only lymphatic, whenever there is venous obstruction, venous flow obstruction, even then there is edema. So these should be noted. But whenever there is venous obstruction, the edema which is there, that is blue in color. You should remember that. Blue color. There will be bluish discoloration of skin if there is venous obstruction. So even that should be noted. Okay, sometimes if you see in advanced conditions, you can see there are multiple nodules. You can see there are presence of multiple nodules in the skin of the chest wall and also in the skin of the arm. You can see multiple nodules because of cancer infiltration in advanced stages. So this is called as cancer en cuirasse. Okay, what are they? This is multiple nodules in the skin with multiple nodules with skin thickening in the chest wall and also arm. So there are multiple nodules and skin thickening in the chest wall and arm. So that is called as cancer en cuirasse. Cuirasse. So this is this looks like an armor coat. So this can also be noted sometimes. Okay. Now, what do you see? Then now you'll have to go to palpation. So we will learn about palpation in our next class. So thank you guys for watching my lecture. If you have any doubt, please comment it in the comment section. If you feel something is inadequate in this lecture, even then comment it in the comment section. Thank you for watching my lecture. Thank you.